Guys, thank you very much for your participation to be here. I will present a little bit about global contents that we have in Singularity University. So our mission, our vision is together, let's impact 1 billion people. So we are asking leaders and people from different backgrounds, from different countries to join us and be able to share content experiences from all over the world to understand the issues that we're facing and try to manage those issues and solve those issues with technology. Our mission is to educate, inspire, and empower leaders to apply exponential technologies to face humanity's greatest challenges. And Singularity University now, it's a rebrand organization. And we are in the intersection between technology, impact, and social impact and business. And we do have a great community all over the world. We are more than 195,000 members, more than 130 countries and territories are in our platform. And regarding the Singularity University, which is a volunteer group that I'm dealing and facing Singularity Guarulhos, which is the second largest city in São Paulo state. And we do have the group members that are organizing some events. And we are volunteer members here. So thank you very much for enjoying our activity today. And just to briefly you about this group, we are a global network with local volunteers, as I said. And our mission is to facilitate communities engage and solve humans' greatest challenge. And trying also to implement the global exponential technology to solve those issues. So the main global issues that we are trying to face is disaster resilience, energy, environment, food, governance, health, and many, many others. As well, as I said, our chapters all over the world, we do have a global community. So we always invite you to be with us and share knowledge and share experience. Okay, we rebrand and also are trying to face those issues, those global issues with this circular learning methodology, which is sharing news, research and insights in the platform. Also with those activities like this, with the events, summits and webinars, and also with training and educational courses. Okay, so not to take too much time here, I'd like to join you, everybody who are eager to understand a bit more. You can just request your if you are eager to participate, you can request to join in su.org. We are gonna be able to share experiences together. And my last message is the best way to predict the future is to create it, as Abraham Lincoln said. Thank you very much, guys. I'm gonna pass my word to Reshma and Prakash. Guys, I think it's better for you guys to present yourself. I think it's gonna be more engaging, and I think we can also save in time from here. And it's up to you now. Thank you very much. Show time from Prakash and Reshma.
Thank you so much, Mateus, for the warm welcome. Before we begin, may I request people in the audience to mute their mics, just so that the others in the audience are not facing any disturbance, any background noise. It'll be really helpful for us. So please help us with your mic on mute. I am Prakash. I'm the co-founder of 1001 Stories. It's an India-based behavioral science and context architecture consulting company. What does it mean? We'll find out in a couple of minutes. However, what is interesting to note is I am just like most of the Indians, just like many Indians, an engineer by training. That's what happens in India. You grew up and you perform decently and you take up engineering. And so I do not really have a formal background in any of the psychological or social sciences. However, I did do my MBA at some point of time. And that also means I feel I'm qualified to have a lot of opinion on a lot of things, whether I know it or not. There's the power of an MBA. So that happened to me, which means there might be times when I might misspeak, right? So you will have to be very patient with me and forgive me whenever I make mistakes. After working in various roles at some point of time as a programmer, later as a manager, I decided to put down all my experiences and all my findings, insights, and ideas together. And along with my co-founder here, we launched a company called 1001 Stories. The basic premise of the company is it is very easy to find solutions. What we mean is everybody has answers, right? The moment you have any question, any problem, anything in the world.
I think we'll have to preface that with everyone can find solutions. They don't have to be good solutions. They can just be solutions. And that's enough.
But the real challenge, and Anish will talk about this sometime, is to find the question. And it was with this insight that we started 1001 Stories. The idea was to be able to frame the questions better. And hopefully, if you can frame a question better, you'll find a better solution. That's me, and there's Reshma here.
Hi, yeah. So, Mateus, first of all, thank you so much. That was very sweet, as usual. It's really nice being here. I'm Reshma, and I've co-founded 1001 Stories with Prakash. We are, again, as you said, a behavioral science and context architecture consultancy. What that means is essentially that we use our understanding of how much we don't understand what being humans is like and about. And we try and see what solutions can work around or what exactly, what are the problems around just being this human that we don't understand being. What are the problems and what are the solutions around that area? What do you do with something like that? What do you do with understanding human behavior and looking at context? What really happens with that is you can solve problems for brands, you can solve problems for policies, you can solve problems for governments, you can solve problems for products, systems, essentially everything that a human being touches can be made bigger, better, can open up, can adapt. And that's essentially where we come from. My experience comes entirely from research and advertising. I have a branding background. And what it teaches you about, what I think I'm very grateful to that experience in advertising for very many years, because what it teaches you is that this is one of the most powerful tools that we have at our hands, marketing. And what we generally do to try and influence human behavior is we try to just tell people what to do. And we try to just tell people that this is really good in different ways. And then we try to influence behavior. It is one of the most powerful tools that we have. And yet the only way that we use it is to communicate. And I think that was precisely actually the reason that we jumped in and at least I jumped in and said, let's 2001, let's work with 1001, let's go beyond telling people what to do and let's try and actually make it happen. So that's a fairly long introduction. I think we can start.
So two things. Number one, we are assuming that most of the people in our audience may not be familiar with what behavioral science is. There's the assumption which you're going. Hence, the content is appropriately prepared for that audience. Number two, we'll try to wrap up the session in 45 minutes. We will fail, but we'll try to wrap up the session in 45 minutes from now. Yeah. Let me share my screen. Let me know, guys, whether you can see my screen. Mateus, you'll have to help me with screen sharing. you may have to transfer co-host privileges to me.
Okay, now you can share it. Just check it out.
Yes. What I need to do is, all right, give me a moment.
Yes.
I had your behavioral science students took me a lot.
All right, I think we should all be able to see the screen by now. Let me know.
All right. Yeah, we can see it.
Thank you so much. This session is called The Brain Versus You. It's a glimpse into behavioral science and context architecture. This is a pretty interesting, also a little common maths question that floats around a lot. Some of you might have seen it. Some of you are probably seeing it for the first time. A very simple question. Bat and ball cost $1.1 to get, but cost like a dollar more than the ball. And the question is, how much does your ball cost? Now, if you pose this question, right, most of us come up with the same answer. And the answer is, well, how do I get people to type me?
I think they're on.
On the chat box? All right. Yeah. So if most of you look at the answer for this, anybody cares to put our answer out in the chat box for us? Not you, Priyanka. Anybody else? All right. So most of the time when people look at this question, they come to the answer saying, all right, so it's 10 cents for the ball and like a dollar for the bat, because it's a very fast maths processing done by the brain. Lance knows the answer, fantastic. All right, we've got smart folks out here. But when you ask people in general this question, right, this is the answer they come up with. And this is what we're trying to understand, what exactly is happening out there, right? But before we do that, a quick preface. Everything has been said, we've come too late. Men have been thinking for living for like 7,000 years for now. And essentially, what this means is most of the time, things that we talk about, listen to, or learn, they seem pretty obvious to us. Number
Everything
one.
That had to be said has already been said. So technically, we are wasting your time here.
Technically. All right. The second important thing I want to keep in mind is the Evinghaus forgetting curve, which says that your brain starts forgetting information the moment information hits it, right? And the decay is exponential, which means by the time it's New Year, people who have been listening to us right now, they would barely remember maybe like 10%, 5% of whatever we spoke today. These two are facts, right? So let's go ahead keeping these two facts in mind. The best way of going ahead is by telling you a story, and our story begins some 13.8 billion years ago. There is a Big Bang. No one has seen it, but all the information that we have today points us. This is what we know, right? All with all the data we have today, there probably was a Big Bang 13.8 billion years ago. All right. And then somewhere around 4.5 billion years ago, life appears on Earth. So again, this is all extrapolation using data that we have. Now, 4 billion years go by. And then half a billion years ago, around 500 billion years ago, right? Your brain makes its debut. So mind you, 4 billion years, life is continuing on Earth in different forms. No one has felt the need for a brain. 4 billion years, all right? And then your brain appears, right? And then the next thing that you know is this important part of the body, the brain, right? Which we pride on as humans. You know, the reason we are connecting with each other is because of the brain that we have, the technology that we can control. the fact that you can talk with each other and connect on Zoom, right? What is interesting is there are actually animals like the sea squirrel, which actually begins its life with a brain, and then at some point of time, it decides that the brain is consuming too much of its energy, and so it absorbs its brain, and decides to continue into adulthood without the brain.
It just refuses to live with the brain. I think it's a simple life as well.
It's a simpler life.
It's just a sponge that it filters the water.
It uses tiny particles and decides this is life. No Zoom for me, no webinars for me.
I don't have to attend Singularity University. I don't need a brain. I can just do this.
I can just do this. Right? So, you have a brain. The brain has got two tasks. The first task is an internal task, which is essentially run your body. Right? Your central nervous system, your heartbeat, your neurons, regulation of fluids, excretion, and 2,000 different things, antibodies. How do you regulate all of this machinery to make sure the body functions, right? And the strategy is do whatever it takes to keep the body running. That includes make you fall asleep time to time. And it's also interesting that if needed, the brain will also lie to you. And this is going to be important again sometime down the line. What we mean by that is, the moment you feel thirsty, right? You have had those moments you feel really thirsty. Your body is in distress, your throat is parched, all of that. You feel you release the water. And then you drink the water. And within a second, you start feeling all right. What's amazing is if you look at the changes in the body, it takes a couple of minutes, almost 15, 20 minutes for this water that you have drunk to reach the different parts of your body and to get those cells or distress organs into a state of normalcy. So how come you're feeling fine within the second of drinking the water? And the answer is your brain lied to you. The distress signal was a signal generated by the brain because it knows better than you about keeping your body safe. The feeling of satiety, the quenching of thirst, was also a signal generated by the brain to tell you stop worrying now. And it doesn't have anything to do with the reality of the body at that point of time. The brain can lie to you when it thinks it's a good thing to do to keep you safe. Strategy number one. This task number one, internal management, right? The second task for the brain is external. The moment you have mobile life forms, it became important for you to be able to, obviously you are moving as a life form, but also there are other life forms moving with you, interacting with you, right?
There is danger everywhere.
There is danger everywhere. Okay, that's a very interesting statement that Reshma says, danger everywhere, because that's the way the brain processes it. What becomes a strategy to keep yourself safe from external danger? See better, right? That's just strategy number one. So we start developing vision. I'm talking primarily about human beings right now. At this point of time, 50%, I think, from what I remember, almost 50% of all activity in the brain is devoted to visual processing. And we have a total of 5 senses, right? The number of neurons, neural networks dedicated to the sense of vision, if you combine the other 4, they still don't match up, right? So seeing better is really, really important for us, for the brain, more than us, for the brain, right? If you try to spot the right eye flounder out here, would you be able to spot it?
Can you catch it? You can tell us. You can unmute and tell us if you've all seen it. This one's easy, right? You can see where it is. It's right here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Can you spot the snow leopard? Mateus, can you see it?
Yeah, I can see it.
Oh, sad.
Even though after a few seconds, pretty hard.
That is oh, fab. Yeah, you're right. I think that's the deal. The fact that, I mean, this is not an easy thing to catch, and yet we are able to catch it. That's how much our brain is dedicated to ensuring that we can see things right. Okay, let's try a tougher one. So these are two pictures, and there is this tail-leafed gecko in both of them. Can you see them?
I might say yes in the first picture. Second one.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah. Pretty hard.
It's this one. Yeah. And in this one, have you seen it in the next one? Lance is like just nailing it. Shall we? So it's apparently this. Yeah. So it's interesting that we're really good at seeing things, right? We're excellent at actually seeing.
Desma, sorry. If you jump back to the lens and also to the tail leaf gecko, because some people couldn't see, so I think it's...
Can they see it now? I've gone back.
So... those who said cannot see it.
It's here. It's supposedly this.
I'm simply going to take your word for it because I can't make out.
I swear, and we put the pictures here and we are like, really? Is that it? Is that where it is?
So, all right. See better, right? That becomes your strategy for dealing with threats that are external. And yet, if you simply, take your finger in front of you, right? And you focus your vision on your finger, any other finger, whichever finger you prefer, and you focus your eyesight on this finger, and you slowly start moving it close to you as an experiment right now with me, try it, it'll be fun. If your eyesight is focused on your finger, and you bring it closer and closer and closer, then you touch your nose with your finger, and then suddenly you can see your nose. The tip of your nose as you touch it. And here's the best part. That picture that you saw of your nose, right? Your nose is there on your face all the time. Your eyes are seeing it all the time. It's your brain that say, that's not important, let me delete it. So what this means is not only does your brain lie to you when it comes to running your body internally, the brain can also decide to delete or change the way certain images are processed just because the brain feels that is the right thing to do for you. Okay. And that brings up a very interesting question. What is real? That particular picture on the left, it went viral a couple of years ago, around 8-9. The blue dress or the white dress, I think that's what they call it. People fight till they put the color on there. Apparently, people say different colors.
See, blue and black or red and gold, I think that's what it is. I see white and gold.
Yeah. Feel free to type in the chat, folks, what is the color that you can see on the dress. What's also interesting is in the second picture, it looks like they're different color.
The gradient, yeah.
But actually it's the same color all throughout. And on the last set of picture, the lens might seem different on the arrows without those markers, but actually it's the same. And so is the dimension of this small bench out there. The second strategy for the brain becomes to understand how to handle too much information. What it means is there is just too many things happening around us all the time. And this, these things around you, they all demand your attention, but you cannot possibly observe and keep in mind each and everything that happens around you. It's just too much information. So the question then is, how do you handle it? So the primal brain, it has got two basic ideas. If something moves, decide quickly. Is it a friend? Is it a foe? Or should I ignore it? Right?
Expressions.
Ignore.
Our ability to read expressions, our ability to look at people and like them or dislike them essentially comes from here. The moment you see someone, you decide, this is someone I trust, this is someone I don't trust. This is a friend, this is a foe. And if then either they, if it doesn't make any difference, then you just ignore them. Then you just, they become your nose.
Then every time I come to a new place, a place which I don't know, or I encounter something new, a non-living thing, I have to again decide, is it safe or is it unsafe? Now, these two decisions, friend, foe, ignore, safe, unsafe, that is primarily the basic rules we use for handling too much information around us. And one way to look at it is to say, you have got limited resources in terms of brain power. We have got limited time available to us. We do not have a lot of time with us, right? Which means with this limited resources, less time and a certain cognitive ability that we have to quickly filter information, number one, make sense of the filtered information, number two, and do something. Take some action on it, number three, right? And that is the entire foundation or basis of what can be called as the behavioral sciences. The whole art of filtering out information because there is just too much of it, making sense of the filtered data and taking a decision once the sense has been made. Right. And for example, one of the ways to filter information, right now, in case you are getting bored, the moment you see a dog jumping in the background, you suddenly pay attention, saying, what's happening out there? Because that's a little bizarre, right? So your mind amplifies the bizarre. Or it is new, it is different, right? Similarly, when it comes to making sense, among the different strategy that the mind has got, one is to become overconfident and have too much belief in your own ability, saying whatever I felt, whatever I say, that must be the correct answer. Similarly, when it comes to getting things done, one of the ways of getting things done is simply do whatever was safe. Why take risk? Why try out something new? Doing the safe thing hasn't killed you, right? So that becomes a way of taking a decision. So there are many ways you can look at these three. Anything here?
No.
Okay. And at the end of the day, you get a very complex, a very popular but very complex chart like this, which says this is a codex of all the different behavioral biases.
They're adding a few every day. And
more or less, yeah. do not let the number of biases overwhelm you. As long as you understand that all biases, more or less, they come up from the fact that your brain has to make use of limited resources, you know, to filter data, make sense of it, and take an action. All right. Which means at a primal level, our brains aren't really very different from the brains of our ancestors, who existed maybe like, 500,000 years ago. More or less, we are the same.
In fact, it's interesting, really. But the point that we want to make over here is the fact that there is a certain brain versus I that is happening to us at every point in time. Are we acting or is our brain just doing things it's coded to do to keep us safe? There are interesting theories about how so many things that are part of our culture today are maybe just misfiring in the brain. We don't know. There's an interesting theory called the bicameral brain. I don't know the bicameral mind. Please read about it. It's very, very interesting. If I were to oversimplify it, it kind of explains the genesis of God to us. It's like, if you think about it, the early man, when they began just hunting and when they began forming their little tribes and feeling safe in their herds, going out hunting together, coming back, and there are hunters, gatherers, all of this is forming. So actually a little before this whole thing is forming, there is no exact thought. The brain, the primal brain is more in charge. Maybe the mammalian brain is more in charge. And it is guided by this. You go hunt in the same locations. You drink water at the same watering holes. You you go to sleep at the same times together, huddled, which is why we like cuddling when we go to sleep, because it makes us feel safe and feel like no one's going to come out and get us. The children are in the middle so that a prey can't, you know, some predator can't carry it away. And these are things we still do. These are things that still make us comfortable. And you don't think too much about it because the brain has ensured that. Don't think, just, I've set these patterns for you, just follow that and we'll all be good, right?
Sorry to interrupt you. There are a few people who are eager to read more about it. So if you just stand by with those titles and the name of the book,
sure,
and
sure.
Later after the presentation, we share all the contents.
Yes, definitely.
Okay.
Definitely, let's do that. So it's a theory, and it's a very controversial theory, but sure, why not? So the theory, what the theory is that at some point in time, and this may have been at the onset of language when we developed vocabulary, at least for this moment, vocabulary might have even just been sounds. They may have been signs that you know, said that this is, you mark something on a tree and that itself is a sign. It's a sign of either this way or that way. It's possibly the first map. It's the first writing. It's the first symbol that you've created to understand something. Mm. So at a time when we've understood something like this, and when there must have been some vocabulary to describe some sort of concepts, the theory says, and I'm oversimplifying, that essentially there are chances that someone has traveled out of the regular path, has gone hunting and has gone so far in the excitement that they've gone a little further. And suddenly you're lost, or you've forgotten the way, or it's suddenly become dark. And now you don't know what to do, and you're in panic. In that state of panic, you're in extreme alertness, and you can hear everything, you look at everything around you, you're in fear, you're overstimulated. And then it's your own mental monologue that essentially says, using the vocabulary that you have just crafted yourself, says, we came in this way, or, you know, you came in this way, go back. Something that happens to us every day. The mental chatter is incessant in our minds, right? And the possibilities that the mental chatter was always there, even for our ancestors, for the early man, they just never heard it, or they just did not identify it, did not realize it. And at this point, in points of alertness, they began to hear these sounds. They began to hear these voices. They began to hear these instructions or these memories or these, you know, go back there. I'm showing you a visual, or I'm showing you, I'm saying something to you, or I'm reminding you something. And the early man's response to this is, whose voice is that? Because I'm standing here and I know my own voice and I know who I'm talking to, but whose voice is that? Who's showing me these images? It's literally almost the first reflection on identity. It's first the first understanding of the fact that there is an I, there is someone inside, but it was perceived as someone else. And that someone else is theorized to be the origin of God. Right? So it's really interesting how the brain is doing its own thing, and there is us who's essentially reacting to these things that the brain is doing. And it's formulating the way we live our lives, the way we form societies, the way we do many of these things, and they may not necessarily be the same thing. That's what we want to say.
Oh, thank you, Ray, for that. A lovely theory for people who are looking for Purthia's question. But before we take the question, Matheus, how long do we have? Do we have a hard stop at 30 minutes?
Yeah, you can continue as long as we can finish until 11 here in Brazil time, 11:30, I think it's the final time that we need to finish. But we still have plenty of time, don't worry.
All right, thank you so much. Purti, I know you have raised your hand. We'll come back to the question in a moment. Let's get a little ahead with the content on the presentation, and then let's get back in time together towards the end for some more questions. But please feel free to share your questions in the chat box meanwhile. Now, this brings in a very interesting way or approach towards solving problem. All the discussion we had till now, right? The whole idea that, you know, the brain tries to find a way to handle too much information. Too quick heuristics, you know, filter information, make sense, get things done, a whole lot of biases. And then you come down to this particular case where the countries noted out there, right? If you can see, some of these countries like Germany, UK, Netherlands, and Denmark, they have a low rate of percentage of population who actually are willing to donate their organs, enroll for organ donations. On the other hand, you look at Sweden, Portugal, Poland, Hungary, France, Belgium, and Austria. And it's almost all of them are at 95, 99 percentile, you know, when it comes to being okay with donating your organs. What's very interesting is this number out here in Netherlands, 27.5, they actually had a sustained campaign around how this is a beautiful thing to do, lovely thing to do, a lot of communication, advertising, marketing efforts around it. And that is how among this group, Netherlands was able to push it to 27.5% after a lot of effort. But what's interesting is if you look at these nations, these are opt-in nations. That means you as a citizen explicitly has to say, I am okay enrolling in this database of people who are willing to donate their organs. If you look at these countries out here, the ones with almost 100% population saying, I'm okay with it. These are the countries where your default is to opt out. Sorry, your default is to be a part of the database. You have to opt out, not to be part of it. And what it says is, the underlying rationale out here is, more or less people are comfortable with whatever is the default choice. Doing anything takes time and effort. Taking an action takes time and effort. Whether the action is me saying, you know what, let me enroll in this database, or whether the action is saying, you know what, I don't want to be a part of this database, take me off it. Both the times I need to take some action, and taking action is not natural to us. We would rather not do anything. There are two more similar examples out there. If you look at it, a very famous picture out there, the economy subscription, $59 for just the online access, and then $125 for your print and web subscription. What's interesting is there's also an option for just the print subscription at $125, which doesn't make sense. As you can imagine, most of the folks, they actually go out for this particular option, $125 for both the print and web subscription. Similarly, if you look at the case of the popcorns out here, right? Most of us, when you look at these three possibilities, we opt for the large popcorn because just for 50 cents more, you can actually get a huge amount of popcorn. These are examples of what you can call the decoy effect, again, which comes from the way the mind is organized, the way biases work.
So these are examples of how behavioral science can be used, because it understands the brain. It's talking to that brain that's taking the decision, not really to you. It's talking to the brain that takes those decisions and says, you know what, I know how to talk to you, and I know how to cue you to do those things that work for our products, our brands, our policies, our laws, etc., etc.
Similarly, another case out here when it comes to the power of fee, I think it's a study number done narrowly, if I remember correct. Hershey's kiss is like a cent, 1 cent each. The truffle is like 15 cents more expensive. But in the test, 73% of the people, they would rather go for this this particular candy or chocolate, which is way more expensive if you look at it compared to your Hershey's kiss. But the moment you reduce the price just by 1 cent, in this case becomes zero. Majority of them, almost 69, 70%, 69% of them flipped just because something became free. But if you look at it between 1 cent and the zero, there isn't really much of a difference. And this is why this particular experiment was very, very curious experiment to perform. Right? Goes on to say that it is very difficult for us to resist the temptation of something that is free. Which brings us to the whole Thanksgiving, which happened recently. The idea is that we are very much driven by
Black Friday.
Black Friday. We're very much driven by our biases. And which means...
Right, which possibly means that we think we've evolved quite a bit. We have, but we're more or less still where we started. We are not too far from the primal state that we were when we started off. Again, there are theories that the brain evolved in three parts, and now we are at the most evolved stage. But as you can see, we're not. Our primal states can be triggered. No, this is one person. This is still an individual. An individual's primal state.
Mm-hmm.
But what happens if you look at the collective herd, if you look at all of us together, we're all still humans. We all still have our own, we still come with our defects. We still come with our strategies. And what essentially happens then is that collective herd follows the same strategy and still says the same thing. It says, see better. And it says, see the same things. All of us need to agree that whatever we've seen, whatever we've experienced is exactly the same. Sometime around 30,000 to 8,000 years ago is where we began to create the first cities, come together as a civilized society, so to speak, and evolve from this creature here to all of us on our Zoom screens and become this complex being. And to live as a complex being, we needed to create the shared reality. If there is no shared reality, we don't know if what, it's the only way to live in a herd. You must all agree that this is the creature to be killed. You must all agree that these are the creatures who are friends. You must all agree that someone must protect, someone must stand guard, procreation can happen. Do not take someone else's mate. Protect each other, hunt together, follow the social hierarchy. We have to follow that shared reality together. And with that shared reality, to communicate and to connect better with that shared reality comes language, comes vocabulary, comes creating a common defined concept that we can all believe we think together. Interestingly, that's what we do with shades. That's what we do with colors. We're all calling it, this is an age-old debate. It was philosophical, it's become scientific. But do we all see the same blue? Do we all see the same red? When what I see red, what I call red and what you call red, are they the same colors? How will you ever know? How do we know? In fact, interestingly, studies also say that if you things that you have not defined, or things that you have super defined.
Mm-hmm. Language can affect reality.
Absolutely.
I think that's what we're trying to come down to. Like if you look at people who are native Russian speakers, they have more than one word for blue. There is no one universal word for blue. Depending on the shade of the word, of the color, the word varies, right? And interestingly, there have been experiments done where people who are native Russian speakers, if you test them with a control group against a control group, they are able to identify shades of blue in those tests better compared to the others, just because they have a word for it.
Chances are the rest of us, because we don't have that concept defined in our vocabulary, we just see them as the same color. But these guys can actually identify smaller tens, just shift in the hex of the color, and they're able to actually identify it as a different color simply because there's a word for it.
You're talking about the pirahas?
The pirahas, for instance. I mean, this is native Brazilian. It's absolutely fascinating. The world of linguists has been fascinated with them for years, for decades. When it comes to color, or when it comes to Mateus, you will be able to guide us better on this, because for us, it's from where we've read it, you'll be able to tell us better. But from what we understand, the words for the numeracy and colors are ill-defined. They're not completely defined. And that completely changes the way that they understand and they look and define their world. Right? They don't have, am I right to say they don't have words for different numbers?
They do. From what I remember, the Pirha tribes have got
many.
Exactly, yeah.
One, two, many. Few, many. I
think it's one, two, few, many, right.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. So what we're trying to say here is, better said by Ludwig with this time, the limits of your language limit the world that you explore and live in. A classic example of this is the word, mansplain. Before that word came into existence, mansplain, it was very difficult for us to understand what exactly that means, the reality.
Or even to identify that it was happening to you. Mm-hmm. But the moment the word came into a collective social consciousness, the moment it happens, you catch it. Because now the concept is defined in the mind. That's the power of vocabulary. And the reason that this vocabulary has been created is because while on one side, while on one end, we are operating as I and my brain, we are also operating as I and my society, which is one collective hive, which is one collective brain. And language is a beautiful way to create those shared realities. From those shared realities, coming down from language, come rituals, social norms, structures, laws, things that become the governing units of our society. These allow for us to share reality even more. And the stronger the shared reality, the stronger, the most safe we feel. This is just how different cultures across the world develop and then make these. There are these very strong traditions and cultures that are then followed throughout, and there's a very strong sense of belonging to them because of these shared realities that we share. Because we need to belong to the herd. So
what's interesting is it's not just with our peers that we share these realities. We also want to make sure that the next generation and the people and their kids, right, they also share these realities, this custom, this rituals, these beliefs with us. We want them to continue even after we are gone, in a way. So the question then becomes, what do we see together? We're right now talking about not individuals, we're talking about individuals part of the larger collective or society.
If we're so good at seeing things as individuals and then collectively we come together and become a mind, then what do we see together? We see common tropes that become our culture, that get shaped in our collective consciousness. I wonder if you guys remember this image. It's an iconic image. What match was this?
This was Ali versus Listen.
Listen. We remember these images. They're burnt in our memory. This is in the time before the internet, before everyone really had a television in different parts of the globe. Everyone still recognized this pose. Everyone remembers the moonwalk. they don't really know, you don't really know where you first saw it, but you know it's in, it's almost like it was just embedded in your memory.
The Napalm girl, the monk from Vietnam, was his high monk, sorry, 67 protest, and then the disaster, the Hindenburg disaster, and then of course this, right? So it's not just that the individual sees things. The reason we put up this iconic image is to make the case that even society has an eye, even the collective has a mind, a memory, or a vision, or a visual to see and process the world around it. Which brings us to our next question.
Are we really seeing the same things? Sure, we all see. We have decided on what is the right thing to see, what is the wrong thing to see, what is good, what is bad, what is safe, what is unsafe. But are we really seeing the same things? Or is there a possibility that we all share the same world? We believe we live in that shared reality. But is there a possibility that each and every one of us looking at that world outside is perceiving the world differently? But because we live in a shared reality, we've begun to believe that everyone else is also seeing the same thing. This is a simple, very simple way to put it. This is you, and this is the world. This is you looking at the world. This is your line of sight. But actually, what's really happening is that we are not just looking at the world, we are also seeing the world looking back at us. So we're not really here. We are here. You're somewhere here where you're not able to really see yourself. You're only looking at yourself in conjunction with the world. To borrow from good this omens. From Good Omens, correct, thank you. To borrow from Good Omens, this is a beautiful way that they put it, where they say, it's how people standing in Times Square in New York can't see the rest of America. How are you supposed to see the whole world? How are you supposed to understand what the world, how the world is functioning, how your own world even is functioning, when you're right in the middle of it? And the only thing that you rely on is what you see. We fail to take into consideration that what we believe is an entire system is actually just that system's association with us. That's all it is. It is a perceived reality. It is not really there. It's an important thing to understand.
This conversation might seem almost in the spiritual realm, because we're talking about world association, us and our connection, right? However, this has got a lot of implications for us in terms of marketing, in terms of cities, in terms of policies for government, in terms of
in terms of the way we ideate for tomorrow. In fact, this is exactly why we talk about sight, because there is a fundamental deformity of sight. Zoomed out, essentially what you realize is that this is an individual issue, where an individual looks at the world without realizing that what he's looking at is his association with the world. But brands, companies, organizations, governments, people, we are all just collectives of people. And zoomed out, this deformity of sight clouds the visions of entire communities, entire nations. It's why one nation has a problem with another, has a problem with a race or with a sect, or believes that one particular target audience is all that that audience is, or it lives in a bubble about what their audience really thinks as brands. When we see these problems around us, and it exists because of this fundamental deformity of sight, collective or individual.
One simple way to understand this is, you look at masks used to fight COVID, and if you look at some societies, in this case, for example, the Japanese societies, people are going to be okay with wearing masks, more or less. And I looked at one of the research out there, and I said the reason that they wear masks or they comply is pure pressure, the most important reason.
So one of the most, yes, one of the most compliant audiences when it came to when this whole, during the last 2 years, mm-hmm. With all the problems that the world was facing, with everybody was figuring it out. I mean, from people to nations, everyone was just figuring how to deal with this new situation, right? And in the midst of this, it was as simple as that. The thing, what can protect you? It's rational. It's logical. Wear a mask, protect yourself, and keep your neighbor safe. It's as simple as that. Why are some people following it? Why are others not following it? Are the Japanese following it because they are better people than the rest of us? Perhaps, but also because within the culture, embedded within the culture, is the need to follow social norms very strongly, is the need to save face as a concept, and the need to say that if I am the only one out with the mask, then I am going to be humiliated. People are going to look at me, just the fact that they look at me and I'm not doing something that is part of society, what society expects of me, is terrible. And this is what is defining it. Whereas
if you look at the American society, their shared realities are different. And we all know the story of the protests right now, the, you know, the anti-vaccine movement and all. And what is curious is, as you're researching, this is not something new. In fact, almost 100 years ago, during what is now called the Spanish flu pandemic, we've had similar protests, similar refusal to comply or wear masks in the US. And you know, as you can see, it happened in 1918 also. The reason for that is in the whole shared reality or the common cultural memory or in the American context, the most powerful ideas are the ideas of freedom and individuality. So in this context, in this shared reality, asking someone to wear a mask becomes a violation of their freedom, from where comes a refusal to comply. Because, you know,
the villain of this entire situation, who is taking away the freedom of the common American, is not the virus. It is another group of people who want to muzzle them the way they see it. So the villain has shifted, and that is the context of the country. It's something that has repeated from then to here. It's exact same story, because the context is almost, it's engraved in the DNA of the country. And if that is the case, then the reason that we talk about this is the reason we talk about context, because on one end there is behavioral science, and we wanted to talk about behavioral science, how powerful it is, the fact that you almost have no control over what your brain really wants to do. Who's the master here, you or your brain? It is very clearly the brain. You don't even know what's happening, right? But nonetheless, even though that is the case, there is a collective, and that our individual behavior and biases feed into the collective, and the collective's brain feeds back to us. And these are two different operating forces at the same time. One cannot look at only behavior. One needs to look at context. The reason we talk about this is because...
But if I may interject just for a moment.
Sorry,
okay?
Yeah.
So far, we have touched two ideas. The first idea is the idea of the individual brain, which is predominantly guided and controlled by your biases, your heuristics, currently biases and heuristics, because of which it becomes easy for us to find solutions to some problem using, let's say, the power of default, the power of free, some sort of social proof, a loss aversion. You give in those emotions and you can find a solution, right? Number one. Number two is the awareness that we now have that the individual is also part of the collective. And the collective has its own context, its own vision, its own
purpose,
its own collective memory. And then people who are a part of the collective, they react to the cultural modes, to the social norms, to the contextual reality of that the setting or the group that they exist in. So two important concepts we have touched, right? Which means you know, if you look at the Japan versus US case, you cannot go up and say, you know what, social proof works. It worked for the Japanese. Let me pick up the same idea and create a solution or an intervention and put it control C, control V in the case of the Americans. It just does not work. And the reason for that is while we are individuals, we're also part of collectives. And like we said, different collectives can have different shared cultural realities. The concept now we are touching up is a third part of it, which is another layer on the individual versus society. And that layer is what is called the second order effect. Ray, you were speaking.
Right. What do we do with knowing this, that there is behavior and then there is context? And so what happens with that? And the reason we're talking about this is because essentially the way that we look at the world right now is we think usually what happens is that what we like to believe is that there is a problem. And then to solve the problem, we place an idea. And because we place this idea in this problem, we have corrected a system. The way that it generally works is that we come up with an idea and then we try to look for a problem that fits it. And then we hope that it's going to bring changes in the system. Both of these approaches, more or less, I wouldn't say they're wrong, but they're not complete. Because what really happens is that there is an idea that is affecting a problem which is in a system that's connected to multiple different systems. And a change in one system can trigger changes in many different systems. And more often than not, exactly like the way that the individual brain reacts, it tries to stay away from change. It tries to come back to as many repetitive patterns it can, safer, tried and tested, unthinking methods. So the moment you bring too many changes into a system, ideas backfire. If they don't backfire, they lead to other problems. And other problems that are unresolved because our idea was trying to affect only one thing. We have an example for this, and I think this is one of the last things that we'll cover, and then we should be done.
For those who know, well, good for you. For those who don't know this story, it's a very interesting story. In the late 1800s, Hanoi. This was, I think, under the control of the French. And so they kind of redeveloped Hanoi. They want to make it beautiful, you know, they want to make it worthy of
the
French
colonists,
Empire.
The colonists who were coming in to make it better for them and to create a better city and beautiful city and bring in that architectural style.
Right. So obviously the moment you want to make it a city, you need better sewage. And so miles and miles of pipes were laid down, a new lavatory system. The toilet system was introduced out there, and suddenly the city was, cool and neat and worthy for the French, in the spirit like that, right? So the change which is introduced, the system changes a little bit, right? And the place starts looking beautiful and cool. But now, the introduction of this change changed some variables. So now you've got almost 9 miles of sewage pipe. It is cool. It is dark. It's a paradise for the rats and the mice, the rodents for breeding. And there is no predator out there to trouble them. But what happened was very soon, the entire city had a rat problem. The population of the rats exploded. This was not acceptable at all. I mean, who wants to have, I think the reports were like, people would be in restaurants, they're not eating food, and there were rats like who jump out everywhere in the streets. So the living in the city was becoming really difficult for them, right? So what they did was they hired a group of Vietnamese rat hunters to go and catch the rats, but there were just too much of those rats. And so the hunters could not catch them all. All right. So now, next plan.
Next
change in the system. So they've been a bounty, right? Open to all. Anybody can go and catch and kill these rats, because there's too many of them. All right. How do you prove, though, that you have killed a rat? Bring the rat's body to the municipality. And so now you've got a lot of people trying to kill the rat because you get money for killing them. So
clearly, they didn't think this through.
They put up an incentive out there because they want a particular behavior in people, right? So they put up an incentive of paying them money. But now when you have people incentivized to kill rats, they will kill the rats and they're picking up those dead bodies and going out to the municipality office and saying, here is a dead rat. Which means a lot of dead rats collecting in the municipality office. Not a pleasant situation, right? So a new idea, a new change, a system. Why don't you bring me just the rat's tail? That is good enough proof for me. Don't get with the entire body. Fantastic. That works as a solution, right? So now groups of people are getting just the rat's tail to the municipality and collecting their
emptying the treasury.
But now something curious started happening. People started finding rats without the tails running around. Like, why was that happening? Because of the way the system was designed, people understood, if I kill the rat, it doesn't breed. If I just cut the tail and I still let the rat live, it can breed. Rats breed fast. I'm soon gonna have more rats, more tails to cut, more money to make. And so that's what happened. But what was really, really shocking for the French was to find out that in the outskirts of Hanoi, people had started rat farms to grow them in large numbers so that they could chop up the tail, take it down to the municipality and claim money. Now, this is obviously a very sad situation, which was not at all acceptable to the French. So they did the final change in the system. From today, no more incentives, no more payouts for killing the rats. System is done with. That backfired even more spectacularly because now people had no reason to farm these rats.
So they just let them go into the wild.
This is let them go in the city. And so now you have the entire city overrun with the population of rats. And I think what followed next was the plague. Now, there are no records of how many people died, so I don't have those details with me.
There was no incentive to keep the records either.
The records either, right? So, but suffice to say, like Reith was saying some time back, right? Systems are interconnected. Anytime you introduce a change in the system, the change does not remain confined only to the system. It can start impacting other systems. This is what we mean by the second order effect. So when you're trying to solve a problem, for example, if you're trying to create, and we tell this because this particular story is based in real life observations. If you try to introduce, if you try to get the girl child to be more educated, to study more, it's a lovely goal. So you can do your interventions and you can get them to study more. What happens after 10, 15, 18 years though is the girl child is actually more educated now. And depending on the cultural contextual reality that she lives in, it might become difficult for her parents to find a groom who has matching education. And nobody wants to get married. No girl wants to get married to a guy who is not
in these cultures
as educated as her, right? So this does not mean do not educate the girl child.
But what, so now the second order effect of this is essentially that if the girl has to get married and she does have to get married, it is not necessary that because she has gotten educated, she will now go out and seek work and become independent. No, she's only got the education and what she intends now is to marry into a family where the boy is better educated and can offer a better financial stability and security, which is not available in the same town or in the same context. So she's going to have to, her parents have to find somebody outside their village, outside this community, and the girl goes far away into a new context where she cannot adapt. Or even if she does adapt, coming back home is very difficult. On the other hand, what it also does is that the boys in the area are left unmarried. Because all the girls who have gotten better educated want to leave and go to another place. It could lead to more violence, lead to a bunch of different things. I mean, there are so many effects. And if we just remove the tags of good, bad, ugly from them and look at them as changes in the system, we are actually able to see that we're actually able to see what one change brings into a system. How many different changes does it actually trigger?
Mm-hmm.
And this is why we talk about, this is the reason that we say that when we work with behavioral science, and it's working with behavioral science is one thing, but working with behavioral science in tandem with context, trying to influence behavior in tandem with context is where you're able to actually bring results. You're actually able to even see your second order effects better, rather than just focus on the one change you want to bring. In summary,
there are some beautiful interventions, solutions, some may call them hacks, that can be designed because our brains are primal and they respond to, you know, cognitive biases because they can't help it. And that is true. So you are going to respond to the power of default. You are going to get influenced by the power of free. You are going to get influenced possibly by loss aversion, by scarcity,
you're influencing,
and by social proof.
You're influencing micro decisions.
Mm-hmm. However, like Reshma was saying, these influence micro decisions. However, we are also individuals existing in a collective. And that means we respond to respond to the context around us. And the realities that we share, some of them are not shared with everyone. Some of them are shared only with our groups. So the other part of it is there is a complexity which arises from second order effects, unintended consequences, consequences which are not very easy to predict, which only become obvious in hindsight, right? So there is that complexity also. So now if you have all this reality with you, how do you actually solve problems, whether these are commercial problems for corporates or whether these are public policy or developmental problems and solutions for society and governments, right? That becomes a question. And the answer, you have to rely on context. You cannot simply go out and have the same sort of solutions going out from one society, one country, or one culture to another. Solutions are very much dependent on the context in which they are applied. Or as typically students in the MBA world says, it depends. And this is where we are coming back to. In the beginning, we said, everything has been said and we've come too late. Men have been living for like 7,000 years and more. So there really is no point in learning or paying attention to anything because it's all been discovered and seen. But then the counterpoint to that is nobody listens. So you have to keep on going back to your basics and begin all over again. So this is our approach to solving problems, what we call context architecture. And I understand there will be a lot more questions saying what exactly is this way of solving problems, because you gave us three important ideas. Number one, the world of behavioral science in terms of biases and heuristics and how you can have solutions coming from there. And number two, the world of context architecture, where you look at the larger context, larger societal realities before looking at understanding and designing solutions. But then there's also a third aspect. What happens after 5 years, 8 years, 10 years down the line, right? And how can that lens influence the understanding that you have? And how can that lens influence the kind of intervention that you may want to introduce? So thank you all for listening. And I think if we have the time, we can take up questions right now.
If Mateus,
thank you very much. Yeah, Reshma Prakash, amazing introduction of this content. I think it's, if we can share more and more, of course, it's a long conversation, a long presentation, but indeed it was pretty funny. I do love those dynamics, those activities as well, those topics. And I do invite all of the members here and also throughout the Singularity Universe platform to go in 1001 Stories site, website, and LinkedIn from another events that you are organizing. I think you might introduction as well the next event. So please share the next event in December. I think everybody will love. And I open this opportunity for you as well to invite those members here. And then I think one or two questions to be able to share those contents with the members here. So I will pass again the word for you. So please invite all of us to the next event in December.
Thank you so much, Matheus, for having us here. I'm now able to actually go to the chat. It was difficult to go to the chat while we're presenting, but I see a good amount of comments out there. I saw something from Lance, which was around
Lance,
something
put in
Singapore.
The name. Yeah, I put in the name of the concept in the book.
Mm-hmm. At this particular case, you talk about Lance of how Singapore is an opt-out country, but we've still got very low rates out there. I'm not aware in details of this particular case, so it'll not be right for me to have an opinion on it. However, I would like to take a look at this in details. And the other part that we're talking about, the larger contextual realities, what is different about Singapore, which causes this, that people are actually taking the effort to opt out. I'm not aware of at this point of time, but thanks for bringing that to my notice, Lance. I would like to take a look at it. And let me just go down a bit out here. Purti, yes, the Cobra effect. Yes, Purti, you raise your hands too. I think we can take a question right now, please.
Yeah, please, Purti, unmute and able to.
Yeah. So hi, Reshma, hi, Prakash. So my question, the previous question was very, very different, but now the question is about the context. So any intervention that you actually implement, right? It has a periodic system. You want the intervention to go periodically rather than linear, right? So when supposing it's an organization and it's, you know, you have implemented an intervention and the organization scales up, right? So the intervention that we've implemented would not work in the manner that it was. So how do you, so definitely the context changes, right? And it also happens with policies also. So as the context changes, the policy remains the same. Like, you know, we have MNREGA, which like largely talked about, all of that, right? So how do you deal with those barriers? And, you know, how do you deal with those policies that were far more implemented in other generations? And the context has changed in a larger group now, because, you know, we have evolved into more of, you know, connecting in a world of technology, right? So how do you diminish barriers and carry out this whole policy, remaining the policy not leaving in essence, but also having more results to it?
Purti, let me rephrase the question and then tell me if I understood it correct. Your question is that there is a certain periodicity to systems, to interventions, and, you know, as time goes by, results appear, things change. And so at some point of time, you may have to deal with the repercussions of previous interventions or previous changes. So how do you handle that? Is that the question, more or less?
Yeah. Completely.
All right. Thank you so much. A fantastic question. First answer, the caveat here is we do not really work with the government or NGOs to implement policy solutions, right? So this answer which I'll give you right now, it comes from more from
it comes
meditation.
From possibly a project or from looking around us and
it comes more from philosophy of how things should be done, primarily because we work a lot more corporates creating products or business solutions, not so much with government, right? So the philosophy is, be with me here. If I go too far away, pull me back. All right, Reshma, do this job. The understanding that we have most of the time is, you know what, I'm going to do something. And this thing in front of me is static, which means I put my changes and then everything works fine. I think the first thing is to accept that it is not going to remain static. It's an alive system. So every time you introduce changes in the system, there are going to be repercussions. Number one, that's the first thing. Number two is to have the understanding that you are not going to be able to predict all the changes that are going to happen. It is just not possible. Systems are too complex, right? In the previous case, when we spoke about that, the education of the girl child, Ray, was it from the state of Haryana? It's like a 2-decade long thing which happened from the state of Haryana in India. And at this point of time, the whole idea of, you know, stopping female and infanticide and promoting the education of the girl child has a very interesting effect down the line, where guys who take jobs in the army as jawans, right? Not as the officers, but as jawans, they would not find good brides. Nobody would be willing to get their daughters married off to them till like 3-4 decades back, because, you know, the posting could be in the remote area of the country. He or he might have to go out to a war, and, you know, there's a lot of risk out there, right? But in today's world, this same particular jawan in the army has become a desirable group simply because he is the one person around who has that education level.
The bare minimum qualification that matches the bride.
The bride education level, right? So,
it's reversed a 30-year trend. This exact same thing. So what are the changes in the system? I think essentially, this is exactly why you need to study context. This is exactly why you need to look at the context of the environment that you're trying to change and understand as much of it as you can. I mean, context is almost like, you know, there is this, the old adage that I know, you know, 1%, and you know that you don't know another 1%. And then there is a whole 98% that you don't even know you don't know. Mm-hmm. Context is like that. Context is that area that you don't even know you don't know. And you have to try and push and see as much as you can in your context. Look at the different pillars that define your context, the time of your context. I think that is another important thing to look at. I have another another point of view here as well, Kirti. If I understand your question also correctly, it's, there is a certain system that operates in a certain way during a particular context, and then the time changes and the system remains and it doesn't work for that context anymore, right? That's essentially what you're saying, right?
I have one more thing to add here, Reshma. Behavior remains the same, right? So when you have behavioral interventions, so capturing a larger system with the small nudges that we do to keep the system periodic, right? Sometimes they fail. Like this is something that I have been reading about. Not exactly, I've not tried and tested an intervention as such, but currently I'm working in one of the organizations where I have to provide employee experience, for example, right? So it's a big, huge field, right? So the behavior remains the same. The neurons remains the same. The neurotransmitters are the same. The context has changed, right? Like the scaling, the number of people that we were looking when we started the intervention and the number of people in the organizations have changed, or, you know, they've increased. So there's this huge power of interventions that, you know, you've tested the intervention in somebody else, and now there's the whole new batch right? And the intervention fails. So that's the confusing, like the context.
That's what you're talking about, right?
Yeah.
I think in this case, the context that, I'll give you an example, maybe it's easier to talk about it with an analogy. You know how all of these travel sites, they keep doing this, when you go there and you check out a hotel and it says quickly, only two more rooms left, or only one more room left, or in 15 minutes, this thing is going to go out. And initially, possibly when it came out, people must have been palpitating and going, oh, damn, I'm going to lose this great deal. Let me click on it right now. And then today you don't care. You're like, you know, I mean, it's all right. I'll go to the next one. The person is not changed. You're right. The behavior is not changed. The need has not changed. What essentially has changed is the fact that you've just been overstimulated to the exact same nudge. You also learn. Right. And this is where, this I think is where context and behavior, I think, where they match, where they come together in this very, very thin line. You cannot change the fact that that humans evolve, people evolve, organizations evolve. Right. So at some point in time, you learn. So you learn your way through a nudge. You learn your way through you learn loops. You learn how to go through something in the lesser amount of time, lesser pressure, with lesser cognitive load. You learn how to do that. So at some point in time, if a nudge starts becoming obstructive to your flow, you will see through it. It is going to happen. What we really need to understand is, what is your flow? And your flow will only come if you look at context.
Correct.
What is my cognitive flow? Everything can be a nudge, because we know all the biases and we have all the interventions from all sorts of case studies. So you can apply them in different places. But if that nudge comes in the way of my cognitive flow, at some point in time, I'll realize it, and then I will let it go. I think that is a very important part of actually looking at interventions. It's a very important part of trying to bring change in the system, to understand the system itself. We can't just look at the human being and say, I know his brain, I know where he misfires and you know, which button I press and then what he does.
A lot of it is a game of two, three things, right? Number one is the game of individual versus system. Second is the game of, where am I as an individual? And third is the type of intervention you're using. Let me give an example. If I'm in a family where we all believe in eating and drinking heartily, and you know, like, this is how rich people do it. This is how, when I say rich people, prosperous people. It's a cultural meme from India, hence a particular usage, khate pita ghar ka hai. It comes from an eating, drinking family. You are rich, you're not starving, right? That's your thing. If you come from a family with that kind of a place, right? That's what I'm in a system. It is much more difficult for you to eat healthier, because you coming from that particular system, right? So whatever kind of nudge and intervention you design doesn't really help much, because it's a conflict between the system and the individual. Now let's look at the individual. Where do I stand as an individual? Do I want to fight it? How do I identify myself? Do I see myself as a person who want to get very, very fit, little fit, who is okay, who is meh? Where do I exist? So depending on where I exist, where is my identity lying? The kind of nudge or intervention you put towards me is going to be having different effects. For example, if I am going to be a person who is really, really motivated, what you call discipline, right? Which is not the easy way to bring in behavioral change, though. But if I am one of those rare guys, let's say I'm in the military, my system is very hard right now, I must wake up on time, I must be proper, I must work out. There, a small nudge in the form of a text alert saying, go and do your workout now, is sufficient for bringing that behavior change for a long period of time. Now, if I'm not that person though, your intervention and your nudges will fail. The third part, like I said, is the type of nudge or the intervention, the type of intervention that you're trying to bring in. If it is a notification, an alert kind of an intervention, it will work for some time, because it is simply serving as a trigger for me at that particular point of time to do it. It's not really changing me as a person at my core.
It's a micro decision.
You know? So it is not really going to bring any long-term change in me.
I'm sorry, I know we're going on and on, but it's an interesting question. So if you look at that same example, which is of the travel portal, I think one of the main things, who are the people who are coming on travel portals, and what is the state of mind when you come on the on a travel portal? Your vacation begins. This is context again. Your vacation begins not when you go for the vacation, when you start planning your vacation, right? For those of us who've been able to travel through COVID, the moment you could, after your restrictions, you're waiting to get out. So the moment you start planning, you're in the vacation. In this mode, you don't want to be stressed. You don't want to be tensed. You don't want to feel like you're losing out. You don't want to have those palpitations. Soon enough, you will let go of it. You'll say, you will convince yourself that because I am in this mode and I want to feel good about it, this deal is not going anywhere. I'm going to get something else that is better. You'll convince yourself that it is still human behavior. This is also human behavior. This is the brain still telling you, no, don't worry. Everything is fine, right? I mean, you can call this being an ostrich. You can. So it's another bias that is coming into play. You're trying to bring in another bias, but there's another one acting, right? So understanding the cognitive flow, understanding the context in which this person is coming to take the decision becomes very important, Purti. Mm-hmm.
That's amazing, guys. I think we should thank you guys very much. I open you to invite all to the Now Fest. I think it's going to be awesome again. And please invite all of us to be there. And then I will formalize and finish this great activity here. And I always pretty thankful to be with you guys and to share all this content, which is amazing. And we can still talking about a long time, but so please invite all to the Now Fest. I think it's going to be awesome.
Yes.
Well, thank you so much, Mateus. Lance, I couldn't take your question, but please feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn. I like your question. We can talk about that separately, one-on-one for sure. Yeah. And for everybody who is joining from different corners of the world and out here in Zoom and who's watching it later live on the platform, the university, on 10th and 11th of December, we are getting the second edition of Now Fest done. It's a two-day event. It's a celebration of context, behavioral science, marketing, innovation, and it's got people from all over the world. And I really mean all over the world who's going to come. Last year, we had 73 speakers from 21 countries who came down to talk about their work, how they look at the world. And the topics that we covered last year, it went from economics and academics to entrepreneurship to hip hop. And then we talked about Jeet Kune Do and Bruce Lee's style of creating a new martial art and how that connects to the world of solving problems. So it's a mad, crazy festival.
In fact, this time, the professor, the scientist who studied the Piraha clan and
Dan Everett,
he's going to be attending the Now Fest. He's going to talk to us about vocabulary and linguistics and how that shapes our thinking. He's going to be there. It's going to be brilliant. So please come. Please do attend. Please register.
All right. Have fun. Please feel free to connect with me and Ray on LinkedIn. You can find us.
Absolutely. Over there. Find us.
And we are totally fine with people booking appointments and sitting and chatting with us about what we do, about behavioral science, about context architecture. Or about anything
as usual, the conversations go on way beyond stipulated time. So
lovely, amazing. Thank you, guys. It's a pleasure to have you here, to have you all, those who being with us until this final. And it's a lovely time with you. Thank you very much again, and see you again next time on the Now Fest.
Thank you so much. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Mateus. Thank you so much.